Greetings, Guardians. My name is Byfear. So, in the weekly update this week, Bungie dropped a lot more detail about the Foundry weapons that we're going to be seeing in The Taken King than I expected they would. So I'm going to go through and explain as much of it as I can to you. Some of it is still a little bit mysterious even to me, but as far as we know, these new Foundry weapons are going to add up to what is basically a huge addition to Destiny's arsenal. There's going to be more weapons in Destiny added in The Taken King than there were at Destiny's launch. So yeah, seriously good stuff in terms of variety, not just of the weapon types that you'll be using, but also in terms of their aesthetic, because of course, each of these foundries has their own unique aesthetic. Anyway, let's jump in. We have three foundries to talk about, namely Hakke, SUROS, and Omolon. So let's start out with Hakke. So, Hakke is generally designed around this old 21st century aesthetic. You look at these weapons and you'll think Call of Duty. It's not made to be pretty, but it's made to have a lot of function, and the perks that you'll get are made specifically to make the weapon itself much better. So you'll be experiencing a lot of perks such as, say, glass half full and hip fire and focus fire if you've got an auto rifle. Things that will affect the performance of the weapon itself as opposed to the user. Statistically speaking, Hakke weapons are not going to have any extremes, so there's not going to be anything that's totally out of the ordinary when you start with these. They're all going to have a reasonable baseline range, stability, auto-aim, magazine size, reload speed, things such as that, and that's going to provide a stable basis for which players can build upon these weapons, which I think personally is kind of a nice thing to start with on a frame, although there obviously are some traits that people prefer, so maybe Hakke isn't as specialized as it should be. So, perk trees on Hakke weapons are going to look like this. You've got your first primary scope, which is pretty standard, then you're going to have a second more tactical scope, for example this one will highlight enemies as you can see, and then you're going to have two front-loaded perks. What Bungie means by this is that instead of having, say, your scopes and then a perk and then a binary set of three perks and then your final perk, those two big perks, so something like, say, glass half full and focused fire, or hip fire and, say, army of one, all of those are going to be at the very front of the weapon perks list. So you're going to unlock those first. Your final perk tree is going to be a choice of three, and it's going to be that point at which you kind of unlock that sort of binary choice that really defines the weapon as it plays. So this is going to be where you can see things like snapshot, fitted stock, braced frame, casket mag, things like this. So again, the Hakke perks in particular do tailor towards making the weapon better. If you want to have a weapon that's all about the weapon, instead of a weapon like, say, Bad Juju, where it's all about feeding into another ability, then Hakke is really the way to go, and the 21st century style of shooting really does reflect this. Think of kind of the American way of the gun, you know? The gun is not some extension of yourself, the gun is the reason why you're powerful. And the gun itself, therefore, has to reflect that. The perks that you get in Hakke weapons are all going to affect your combat performance when it comes to your weapon. Next up comes Omolon, and the entire concept behind Omolon weaponry is that it's supposed to look and feel futuristic. It's almost kind of that mad scientist type weapon where the ammunition it uses is actually either liquid or it's polymer. So yeah, totally ridiculous. It's the future of weaponry, so to speak, but some of their experiments genuinely do get a little bit out of hand. They're really the pioneers of energy weaponry in Destiny's universe, which makes them kind of a unique one in the market. And at the same time, their weapons do sport some seriously cool looking ergonomic black and blue frames, so yeah, awesome stuff here. Anyway, if we're going to go into the weapon stats, all Omolon base weapons do have really good handling stats at the base, so you're going to have fast switch times, fast aim down sight, all of that, and that's all of course due to the ergonomic frames. Now, when we're taking a look at the talent grid and the perks, there's going to be some slight differences from the Hakke weapons. You're going to be looking at perks that focus on behavioral perks over stat customization. So in other words, the legendary talent grids offer only three perks. One as the first non-scope upgrade, and two binary choices in the final two columns. So, in other words, it's going to look like this. Your first choice is completely out of your hands. The second two choices, however, are in your hands, and you can choose two of them like this. The perk selection on Omolon weaponry is always going to favor stuff that kind of adjusts things in the user as opposed to the weapon itself. So take, for example, the new Underdog perk, which means that the weapon is granted a boost to range and handling when your health is low. Things like these that really make Omolon weapons stand out. They're the kind of advanced tech that you want to use in your kind of flavor builds, where you're doing stuff with your abilities and you're trying to understand how you can push your own character to the limit by not necessarily using all of your weapons. These are the kind of things that I'd be interested to see used in Mayhem Clash, for example. Ultimately, Omolon is almost the exact opposite of Hakke. It tailors to that idea in all Japanese culture that the weapon is indeed an extension of yourself, and then when you act, the weapon is acting as a part of you. Now finally, probably the most renowned of the foundries that we're getting in this update, SUROS. Now SUROS, the entire philosophy behind it is that it is the face of brutality, but given elegance. You have weapons that have curves that are nothing but aesthetically pleasing, and yet the weapon itself is still capable of delivering brutality. There is no question, SUROS weapons definitely are ahead of the curve in terms of the quality of their build. Every single line, every single curve, every single chamfer speaks of that philosophy of elegance and brutality in one form. So, what do their weapons and their perks look like? So, SUROS weaponry is designed to be about as versatile as it gets. The idea of SUROS is that, yes, brutality is a certain thing, but that may be different things at different times. In other words, sometimes you need a pulse rifle that acts more like a long-range weapon, and other times you need one that acts more like a short-range weapon. The versatility in that, and the requirement that you should be able to adapt to a whole load of different combat scenarios, is built into the entire idea of their perk system. So SUROS weapons have two stat perk columns, allowing you to change the weapon stats more than any other foundry that you can see. The single perk that you can get in the middle of the weapon will speak to its core potential, the ability of the weapon to truly function in a certain manner, and whilst there is versatility to be found in adjusting statistics, the core perk is what can define the way the weapon kills anything. So this could be something like, say, full auto on something like, say, the SUROS PDX-45, the new pulse rifle, or it could be, say, tracking or proximity rockets on a SUROS rocket launcher, or potentially even take a look at something like, say, a SUROS auto rifle. Maybe the perk that you're focusing there is hip fire or focus fire, one of these perks that genuinely does define the weapon. This is the entire philosophy behind SUROS. This idea that while you do have a central tenet to what the weapon can do very well, you do also have these hidden adjustments that you can make, and the fact that you can change more stats on SUROS weapons than on any other foundry means that they are more versatile as a general rule. Again, these weapons, kind of like Hakke weapons, can help you modify your playstyle according to the weapons that you use. And again, SUROS weapons, as it has to be said, they're renowned simply because of the SUROS regime, and as a result they're probably the most recognizable pieces of weapon craft in the Tower and in the Guardian world at large. SUROS is truly a name both to be respected and feared. Before I finish, just a few interesting little tidbits that I can take away from this weekly update. Of course, this is not the full line of production that SUROS, Hakke, and Omolon have to offer, as well as that it's well worth noting that whilst these are the only three foundries that you'll be getting in something like, say, The Taken King, more will probably be added later on in Destiny's lifespan. Destiny's new Taken King expansion is apparently going to have the largest selection of new weapons to date. That includes the weapons that got added in Vanilla Destiny, and that's a huge amount, keep in mind. Factions will also be getting new weapons, the Gunsmith will have a new way for selling weapons, and that means finally he's not just going to be selling blues and greens, and also some exciting news, classes will have their own specific weaponry. I don't know what this means, guys, but I have a feeling that we're going to get some exotics, perhaps, that allow us to attune our combat style according to the class we're playing. Or maybe the subclass, rather. So, for example, imagine a new exotic that revolves entirely around the use of the Stormcaller subclass, or maybe some kind of weapon that revolves entirely around the use of the Voidwalker, and therefore those weapons can only be used by Warlocks. Stuff like this could be cool. At the same time, balancing it would be interesting. I'd love to see how this works out, and frankly I think it's a very good idea. Also, one other small little tidbit of news. This week, the map rotation for Trials of Osiris is no longer, well, stagnant. This week in Trials of Osiris, you can see any single map in the map rotation. So one map you could be playing on Burning Shrine, the next you could be playing on Pantheon, the next you could be playing on the Cauldron, the next you could be playing on Widow's Court. You see what I mean. It goes on and on. And frankly, I think this is a really interesting change because, well, heck, it's always been the same map over and over again. Strategies get established, but this one forces you to vary up your game on a constant basis. I don't know how often this will happen, but I think it's a cool idea and it's a neat little break from the single map on Trials every single week, which is a formula that I like, but adding a little bit more variety into this will work too. Anyway, enough of my rambling. My name is Bife. Prodasia Rastra. I'll see you, Starside.